Good morning, my reader friends. Book Dragon Erin here with another book review video on By Any Other Name by Natasha West. I would have to say this book is quite possibly the best lesbian love story of 2021, and this contemporary LGBT fiction romance novel, which is a Romeo and Juliet retelling, only this is a Juliet and Juliet love story. This book is so intense and so beautiful. I loved this standalone, and I wish there was a sequel because I would devour it in a matter of days. It's that good. A few other books by Natasha West include and readers also enjoyed Before we get into discussing the book itself, I want to talk a little bit about Natasha West. She lives on the south coast of England with her wife and their stubborn pet Jack Russell. She writes numerous international bestsellers of the lesbian romance genre. She loves writing about complex, rich characters who aren't looking for love, but find it anyway in the funniest and hottest routes possible. Now getting into an in-depth summary, our story begins with Nanny Whittaker telling her granddaughter Lane the age-old story about why their family has always hated the Goodwin family, many thanks to an old love triangle from 200 years ago. Great-great-grandma Whittaker fell in love with Mr. Whittaker. Great-great-grandma Whittaker gave her virginity to Mr. Goodwin. Great-great-grandma Whittaker was pregnant and was thought to be spoiled goods. Mr. Whittaker then married great-great-grandma Whittaker because he was still in love with her, and they raised great-great-grandma Whittaker's baby as his own. Anyway, Lane was adopted, so she doesn't have 100% reason to hate the Goodwin family, but she wants to prove herself a Whittaker, so she hates the Goodwin family because her family has modeled that behavior for her. When Lane takes her dog, a Labrador named Cracker, to the vet, Cracker is being difficult and Lane winds up falling through the front door to get her dog inside. The embarrassing moment, not soon forgotten, especially by the vet's very attractive receptionist, Casey. Lane thinks Casey is so drop-dead gorgeous that she couldn't possibly get Casey's number. And she also assumes that Casey must have a girlfriend or has had several girlfriends in the past. Also, if Casey is a lesbian, would Casey fall for a girl like Lane? After flirting, Lane and Casey exchange cell phone numbers and start texting immediately. Lane thinks Casey is the most gorgeous girl that she has ever seen, but she has no idea how to flirt because of so little experience with other girls in their small hometown. Unbeknownst to them, Casey takes Lane out on a date to her own family's pub. The Goodwin family's pub shares a rivalry with the Whittaker family's restaurant, and since no one in Casey's family is working that night, no one intervenes or interrupts their date. After eating dinner, Casey takes Lane to her favorite spot by the river, and the two girls talk and have their first kiss together, which feels so right to them both. This is a big thing for Casey because she has never taken a girlfriend out to the river, and Casey has traveled the world and dated many girls, but she all finds them quite boring compared to Lane, who is pure and innocent and sweet. When Lane walks Casey home, she realizes that Casey is a Goodwin, and she is crushed that she has instant chemistry with someone who is meant to be her enemy, and she departs quickly after Casey's mom catches them together. Casey's mom then confronts her, and Casey is confused because her parents are totally fine with her being a lesbian, but why react with so much negativity over a girl? Casey decides that her instant chemistry with Lane is realer than any feeling that she's had before, so a rose by any other name would smell as sweet. Casey doesn't care that Lane is a Whittaker. She is still instantly in love with Lane, but she worries, does Lane feel the same way? After a short time of realizing they can't be seen together in public, they come up with a plan to be together. Go to movie theaters and make out in the dark. Go to coffee shops and sit in different booths while pretending to talk on their cell phones, but in truth are talking to each other instead. And take a train to another town and visit places where they won't be recognized. Wanting to be alone together, both Casey and Lane lied to their families about spending a night with a friend, and they both go to Lane's grandma's caravan where they hook up. Lane gives her virginity to Casey, while Casey thinks it's the best night of her life, and she does wonder, will it blow up in her face later? Over the next few months, Casey and Lane are together in secret, but Lane's little brother catches her with Casey and is outed as a lesbian. To Lane's brother, it makes sense because she has never had a boyfriend before or seemed remotely interested in men. When Lane's family discovers Casey is from the Goodwin family, they are not happy whatsoever and call Casey that Goodwin girl, and don't even mention her name, which I think is so disrespectful. Likewise, when Casey's family finds out that Lane is a Whittaker, they call her that Whittaker girl, like it's a curse or something. And what's even more ridiculous is that the families both try to talk some sense into their girls, and they say, your love isn't real, you're so young, you don't know these things, you don't know about the world. Yeah, young love doesn't always work, but this is real love right here, and they deserve to be happy with each other. It isn't just a single fling and that's it. It means something to both of them, so their families should get over their pasts and just accept this whole romance. It's ridiculous. Getting back into the topic of conversation, no one is happy about Lane and Casey being an item, but their families aren't stopping their young romance, just making snide comments that go totally unappreciated and so unneeded. Casey and Lane decide to meet each other's families, so on the same night, they have two dinners each, one at House Whittaker and one at House Goodwin. The dinners turn out well enough and tensions are low. The Whittaker family and the Goodwin family aren't all entirely different. There are so many similarities, and I did come across one thing that really made me think. I'll get to that in a sec, though. When a secret about Casey's kid sister rises to the surface and is exposed in front of everyone that she has bad kidneys, and if not treated, she could die, Casey and Lane break up, and both girls are miserable without each other. When the families confront each other over this whole mess, there's a huge fight, and Casey's kid brother runs away, unknowing of how to react to the potential demise of his sister. He doesn't want his sister to die, he is so overwhelmed, so he runs away. Where does he go? Casey and Lane then work together to find Casey's brother, and when they do find him, he is perfectly okay. Casey's sister does need medical treatment, and unfortunately, no one in Casey's family is a match. However, history is remembered when Lane recalls her grandma telling her about the start of the feud when great-great-grandma Whittaker was impregnated by Mr. Goodwin, then had Mr. Goodwin's child. Yes, the Whittakers and the Goodwins are actually family after all. Lane and her family are all tested, and Lane's brother is a match to Casey's sister, so he donates one of his kidneys to save her. And by this point, Casey and Lane are already back together, and Casey asks Lane to come travel the world with her and gives the I'll be happy anywhere as long as I'm with you card, and Lane says yes. And the story ends with Casey and Lane heading off into the sunset, heading to Australia, hand in hand, together. This book was so beautiful and so romantic and so sweet and I just loved every moment of it. This had a great start with a modern Romeo and Juliet feeling, but this time with a Juliet and Juliet theme. With the strong beginning, there are more than a few names to remember within the Whittaker and Goodwin families, so I personally needed a pen and paper to keep the family straight. And okay, that pun was unintentional. First date, first kiss for Lane. Not Casey's first date, but I loved how the date meant more to Casey than any other date that she had been on with any other girl before, and it is romantic as heck and has me almost envious. Not really, but almost, because no kiss I've ever had has meant anything to me so far. I have never actually been on a date that has felt right in any sense of the word. And I hope one day to feel that unique spark that Casey and Lane feel for each other, which I think is so beautiful, but I have no idea if I'm ever going to feel that way. I would consider myself a skeptic romantic, meaning I believe in love, I just doubt it will happen to me anytime soon. Anyway, I can totally feel the emotion that Natasha West puts into her writing, even with all the grammatical blunders. This book is such a peaceful and kind of calm Juliet love story, and I recommend it to everyone. A rose by any other name would smell as sweet. I loved how Casey thought of Lane and how she would feel the same connection to Lane, whether she was a Whittaker or otherwise. I was halfway through the book before the end of the first night I picked this book up, and this lesbian love story is actually quite addictive. I was a huge Shakespeare fan growing up, and I tend to love Romeo and Juliet retellings, especially ones that have those happily ever after themes for our star-crossed lovers, and this book is exactly the thing that I love, and if there ever is a sequel to By Any Other Name, you bet your backside that I am going to read that book, because this book was so intense, so beautiful, so passionate. You could feel every single emotion that the characters were feeling, and it was just so beautiful. I am telling you, so beautiful. And as far as ratings go, there were so few that I could come across, but Amazon rates the book 4.3 out of 5 stars, Goodreads rates the book 3.8 out of 5 stars, and my rating, 5 out of 5 stars, this book was absolutely incredible. This book was published on April 13th of 2018, and it is 188 pages long, as far as the Kindle edition goes, and I breezed right through reading this book. It was so quick, and it has me wanting and dying for more. If this book had a soundtrack, I think the songs that would fit best include Crushed by Rosette. This is a relatively unknown song as far as I am aware, but I love it all the same. And of course, a Taylor Swift song has to fit, so I would say that Love Story fits because it is basically the love story of Romeo and Juliet with a happily ever after. And my favorite song of the bunch, coming out, the official song by Allie Hills. I will leave a link to her song in the description box. It is so worth listening to, and it has a great beat. So even if you're not a part of the LGBTQ community, you still really like the song anyway. I don't know if that's just me or if you feel that way too, but I highly recommend it. Anyway, that is all for today, so if you enjoyed the video, hit that like button to show some support, subscribe to my BookTube channel to get more videos like this, turn on those notifications to be notified when I have a brand new video uploaded, keep on reading, and have a great day, everyone! Oh no, it's bad, got me feeling so weak. You're holding my hand, you smile. I die, 'cause I don't wanna feel what I'm feeling inside.
close my eyes and the flashback starts. I'm standing there on a balcony in summer air.
We're all the same, we just want to belong. So let me explain in the form of a song. What you're about to find out, got news to share. So sit yourself down, get yourself prepared. And if this is hard to hear, then you should hit replay.